What happens when you jump in a video game? You go up and then down? There's a bit more to it than that, isn't there? Behind even a simple jump can be tons of physics that are specifically optimized for your game. This makes movement feel natural and gives the player a solid understanding of the physical space they can move around in. Without good physics, genres like platformers, kart racers, and fighting games wouldn't be any fun to play. Thankfully, Flowlab does most of the physics work for you, but you can also tweak the physics of any object in your game. In this video, we're going to look at the physics panel, what properties you can adjust with it, the different collision shapes, and we'll troubleshoot some common issues you may experience when handling the physics of an object. To find the physics panel, click on any object in your game, click Edit, and in the bottom right corner, click Physics. Here, you'll find everything pertaining to the physics of the object selected. At the top, we have the 3 to 4 boxes you can check off. The first option is to make an object movable. Doing so allows for the object to be pushed around by other objects or the force of gravity during gameplay. If movable is selected, then you'll have the option to select Affected by Gravity, which allows an object to fall and react to the force of gravity. Below is the option to make an object solid, which means other objects can't pass through it. Unselecting this means the object can be passed through like a ghost. If solid is selected, then you have the option to allow the object to spin when collided with. If not, then you have the option to allow collisions, which means that if an object passes through it, then a collision is registered. Now we have three sliders that increase or decrease a specific property of the object. Increasing the density of the object increases its mass, meaning it will require more force to move. This can help when adjusting the physics of objects made with heavy material. Increasing the bounce of the object means it will have a greater bounce effect when colliding with other objects. This is great for ball objects. An increase in the friction slows down the force of other objects that collide with the object. This is especially handy for different terrains you want to add to your games, such as icy paths. Below this, you can change the forward direction of the object, which helps when using the rotation or other behaviors that rely on this specific orientation of the object. Along with this, you can set the collision group, which allows you to set which group of objects you want this object to be able to interact with. Finally, there's the collision shapes. You may think that the sprite of an object makes up its hitbox, but this is a distinct shape separate from the sprite. This allows developers more control over physical interactions in their games. Here, you can change the area in which a collision is registered, but this is only available for solid objects or objects in which collisions are enabled. The first shape, circle, is the default for movable objects and works best for any object that needs to be smoothly moved. It's also best for performance. The rectangle shape is the default for any non-movable object. This will encapsulate the sprite in the smallest possible rectangle. The capsule is specifically made for any playable, side-scrolling platformer characters. This cuts the corners of the rectangle and has no friction on the left and right sides of the object. And last but not least, there's the polygon shape, which takes the shape of the object's sprite. You can also create a custom polygon for the object if you'd like. The polygon option allows for more complex shapes, but is the most taxing and should be used sparingly. Remember, if you ever need to see your collision shapes in action, go to the settings of your project and select Display Physics Shape Overlays. This can help you visualize how your collision shapes are interacting with one another. Now that we've covered all of the physics panel, let's check out some common issues you might face when setting up the physics for your game. One of the most common issues when making a platformer is having your players stick to walls when they collide. To make sure your player slides down the wall without dragging, double-check the collision shape you're using. Oftentimes, developers will forget to change the collision shape from circle to capsule. The capsule shape is specifically designed to help eliminate this issue thanks to the lack of friction on the sides of the shape, something that's unique to the capsule shape. Another common issue is deciding whether an object should be solid or simply have collisions enabled. Take, for example, coins in a game. If you just keep them solid, then when the player collects them, it will completely halt their forward momentum, making them very unsatisfying to collect and oftentimes making them become more of a hazard. However, by unselecting the solid option and instead selecting enable collisions, players can collect the coins while keeping their momentum. One final issue you may face is using the polygon collision shape at inappropriate times. This strawberry collectible isn't exactly a circle, so you may think it's best to use a polygon for its collision shape. However, the shape of the sprite is not crucial to the purpose of this object, and a circle would be just as effective while keeping the game's performance at tip-top shape. Achieving satisfying physics in your games can seem daunting, especially for people like me who aren't exactly math guys. But with Flowlab, creating sophisticated physics interactions becomes as simple as a click of a button. With the game editor, you can easily tune the physics to your liking and create the best player experience for your next game project.